since there are many youths here, they requested me to give a general talk, not to follow the daily Buddhist devotion. They are from different schools and having not holiday camp but religious camps. Religious, they will be here up to, I think, Sunday or Monday. This whole month, fully booked, about 40, 50, 60, 70, 80 in one groups for 3-4 days. Come and stay here. It's a very good sign. They organize various activities, talks, games. So, who is the leader of your youth group or the organizer here? So you are the leader, okay? So what do you want me to talk? Can you suggest? Because you can understand their knowledge, what they can understand, what they can appreciate. Life of the Buddha. That I think you can do very easily. Because there's no anyone can do that, life of the Buddha. Tell them something which is important for their day-to-day life and what to do and what not to do. These are the important things. Anything else? Buddhism? Daily life. Right. Now we got the idea. Buddhism in our daily life. First we must understand what is Buddhism. I think many of these young people never had the opportunity to know or to think what Buddhism is. Where Buddhism was originated? In China, isn't it? Can you tell me? No, I'm asking the young people, a student. Where Buddhism was originated? In China or India? Not in China. I thought in China. No. So you know something. Which part of India? South India or North India? That you do not know. Northern or Southern? North India, right. How many years ago? Can you tell me how many years ago the Buddha lived in India? Before Jesus Christ or after him? Before. All right. How many years earlier? How many years? Some people say 500, some others say 600. 500 to 600 years ago, the Buddha lived in India. How many years did he live? 80. Good. He lived. Then what happened to him after 80? Cannot hear, you know. You're louder. What happened to him? Now, where is he now? In India or China? You are going to China from India. But he has gone to China in the first century, 600 years after he went to China. Then, where is he now? Still in China or come back? No idea. China, Korea, Japan, Mongolia, Tibet, he went to all those countries. Can you tell me something what the Buddha taught? Something what he taught? Did you hear anything? Did he ask you to worship him? No. Then what are we doing? Then why do we worship him? If he did not ask us to do that, why do we worship him? Whether he asks or not, that is very important for us, and that is why we worship him. Not necessary for him to tell us to do that, but we like to respect him. Now, why did you choose Buddhism? Because in India, at that time, there were many religions. Still there are many religions. Why did you choose Buddhism? Why Chinese accepted Buddhism? Because the Buddha was not a Chinese. Of course, when you erect the Buddha image in China, you have given him Chinese face. It is natural. It should be like that. So why did you didn't answer my questions? My answer is this. There were many religions in India at that time, even today. So why did you choose only Buddhism? Hinduism is a very, very popular religion in India, but you didn't choose Hinduism. Jainism is another well-known religion. Is there anybody who can tell me why they have chosen only Buddhism? Say something. Do you like Buddhism? You like it. Why? You don't like other religions? So if you are not going to answer, so I'm going to tell you why people in other countries have chosen only Buddhism. Because the Buddha's teachings or Buddhist way of life is not limited, not confined only to Indian society or India. But many of those religions that existed or existing today, their way of life, their practices, their religious ceremonies confined only to Indians. That is the very reason why people in other part of the country chosen Buddhism. The Buddha's teaching is for the whole humanity, whole mankind, not only for one particular country. Very common. It is called universal, common to every human being. And it is not necessary to change their way of life to practice Buddhism. This is another thing. Now, if you accept another religion, you have to follow their way of life, not only their religions. You have to change your dress. You have to stop eating certain things, and you cannot use certain things according to their religion. But after becoming Buddhist, it is not necessary to change anything. You have to stop only your bad thing, not your traditions, or your way of life, or your customs, or your cultural practices. You can carry on as usual. And that is called freedom. People like this freedom. Now, in the West, today, people like this religion. They accept this religion. But after becoming Buddhist, there is nothing for them to change in their day-to-day life. They remain as Europeans. They can follow European customs and culture and tradition. At the same time, they can practice Buddhism. If they accept another religion, they cannot do that. That freedom is not there. They have to change many things. This is a religion of freedom. The Buddha wanted to give us, or teach us, how to think. Do you know how to think? You know? Good. The Buddha wanted to tell us how to think. When you study many other religions, they do not teach how to think. You cannot think. You have to accept what they preach. Now see the difference now. You cannot argue. You have to accept what they preach. The Buddha did not adopt this attitude. He always encouraged people to think and understand what they are doing. Why do they want to do these things? Why they don't want to do these things? By thinking. Not as a law. When they obey the existing law, you follow this law because if you violate it, they will punish you. Because of that punishment, you observe. But you do not know why you should follow this law. And that is not the Buddhist way of life. The Buddha's advice is you should not follow any religious belief or law or practices not knowing why you should do, why you should follow. When you study, when you think, you can understand. not only that. There are some people who are not belong to any religion. They have no religion. They have no God, they have no Buddhas, they have no religion, they have no heaven, they have no hell, they don't believe anything. But they live as cultured, civilized, very understanding, very honest, very kind-hearted people. In other words, they live as real human beings, but they have no religion. That is true understanding. When people can understand that these things are wrong, these things are cruel, these things create enormous sufferings, disturbances. Therefore, it is not nice for us to do such things. That is understanding. Otherwise, many religious people say, oh, we cannot do that because it is a religious law. If you do that, God will punish us. If there is no such punishment, they can do anything, whatever they like. That means there is no understanding. So if you can understand that these things are bad, these things are immoral, these things are harmful, these things disturb others, then our duty is not to do such things. So today I am going to tell you the whole teachings of the Buddha. What he taught, how many years did he preach? Yes, you have to answer this question. How many years did he preach? Yes, young people, you do not know. 10 years? 20 years? 5 years only? 45. Not bad. See? All right. At what age did he become a Buddha? What was his age when he became the Buddha? 35. Very good. At what age did he renounce the world? 29. Very good. 29. So at what age did he die? 80. What happened to him after his death? Going to heaven? No. Why? He cannot go to heaven. Then what happened to him? This is very difficult. Did he go anywhere after his death? Did he go anywhere after his death? Don't know. If he did not go anywhere, he must be there, still in India. Who can give me the correct answer? Did he go anywhere after his death? No. Then what happened to him? You say did not go anywhere. Again you say enter. What do you mean different? Entering and going? Is there any difference? Attain. Again, going and attain. Same meaning. he stopped his rebirth, becoming again, going anywhere, a stop. After becoming the Buddha, he said, Natthi dāni punabhav, no more becoming again, no more rebirth. Because if there is rebirth, again he has to die. Again he has to grow old and suffer. Therefore he stopped everything, free from physical burdens. So he did not go anywhere, either heaven or any other part of this universe. He stopped his rebirth and freed himself from physical and mental burdens and responsibilities. That is called liberation. That is called salvation, freedom. So now I am going to tell you 45 years teachings of the Buddha in brief, within three lines, very easy for you to remember. When you go back, when people ask, what did you learn? Or you say, I learned Buddhism. What is Buddhism? Then you say, life of the Buddha. That is not Buddhism. You must learn what the Buddha taught. Three lines. It's very easy. He said, you must keep away from all your bad deeds. How many bad things are there? So many. As much as that you can. You kill other living beings. You disturb them. You steal others' things. You bluff others. You disturb others. You tell lies. So many bad things we are doing. So the Buddha's advice is not to do such bad thing. Can you do that? Can you do that means, can you promise not to do that? Not to do? Not, do or not to do? Which one you prefer? Not to do is better but very difficult. Try as much as possible. If you cannot practice, then there is no Buddhism. First thing, not to do bad thing. Alright. Second thing, to do good. What are the good things? Be kind to others. Be honest. Support others when they are in difficulties, when they need your support, your services. You must know how to cooperate with others. You should not create enemies. Work together with harmony and understanding. You must have a lot of patience. For certain things you must have patience. You have to tolerate certain things. And these are the good qualities. Those who practice these good qualities do not create troubles and problems and disturbances. Then people regard them as cultured people, religious people, understanding people. So the second line is, try to do good. Third one, try to maintain healthy mind. Our minds are very sick, very sickly types. Always get angry, that means sick. If mind is healthy, we won't get angry. We are very jealous. Mind is not healthy. Sometimes we are very cruel. We have no sympathy towards other living beings. Sometimes we bluff others. That means we are very cunning. All these are mental sicknesses. When we try to control our mind without allowing those sicknesses to disturb our mind, then the mind becomes very healthy, very peaceful. Now we have so many worries, disturbances, unhappiness, or unsatisfactoriness, disappointments. All these things take place when the mind is not healthy. If the mind is healthy, those symptoms never appear in the mind. Worries, miseries, and disturbances. Because mind can tolerate, mind can understand where the mistake is, who is responsible for this problem or this trouble. Mind can understand. When we cannot understand these things, then we create trouble. We blame, we accuse, we fight, we quarrel, we disturb, because we cannot understand. If we can understand without troubling, without disturbing, we know what to do. These are the three things. Let us start again. Remember, when you go back, before you go home, you must repeat and repeat and repeat the teachings of the Buddha within three lines. What is the first one? First one? Not to do bad thing. Second thing, do good. Third one, maintain healthy, pure mind. This is the message of every Buddha who appeared in this world. You know, long, long ago, there were many Buddhas who appeared in this world from time to time. Again, there will be many more Buddhas who will appear in this world. All these Buddhas give the same message, same teaching. The Buddhas have no different teaching. But after the Buddha's passing away, few hundred years after his passing away, his followers, his disciples, created their own imaginations about his teaching. Then introduced different way of teaching.
So 100 years after his passing away, his followers, his disciples, created their own imaginations about his teaching. Then introduced different way of teaching. Otherwise, the Buddha did not introduce different kind of teaching, same teaching. Disciples created, are still creating, new ideas. Now this is the message of the Buddha. Now if people can practice this, whether they are Buddhist or followers of other religions, or those who have no religions, everybody in this world can live peacefully because there is nobody to disturb. Here you can understand the real meaning of the message that Buddha has given for us. That is, for us to live peacefully and allow others also to live peacefully without disturbing them. Now this is for the whole mankind. Those who can understand what are the bad things, what are the good things, can train the mind not to do such bad things and how to do these good things and some service to others. The advantage of learning this Dhamma or the teachings of the Buddha earlier, when you are young, you cannot understand. Now you are learning this as some sort of academic subject to gain academic knowledge, but not to gain proper understanding. When you study, when you think, you keep this in your mind as your memory, as your knowledge. When you are very young, you do not come across so many problems and troubles and worries and disturbances and responsibilities in your life. Because still you spend most of your time in playing and joking and playing, because no responsibilities in your mind. That means you have not taken the responsibilities into your mind yet. That is why you are very free. You can play. But after middle age, after your marriage, when you become fathers and mothers, when you are working to earn, to support your families, when the troubles and problems and calamities and misunderstanding, jealousy and grudge, enmity appear, you do not know what to do. When you are young, you don't feel this thing. The religious knowledge that you develop when you are young, you can use at that time, because your maturity, your age, your experience, your knowledge can elaborate, expand think properly by using that knowledge. Then you know what to do. without worrying, without crying, without fighting, without quarreling, you know what to do. Because you have learned earlier, according to this religion, what to do when we are facing this problem. This is the advantage. There are many who use this knowledge to overcome or to avoid or to tolerate these problems. Because there is no worldly life without problems. Not a single human being is free from these problems if that person lead a worldly life. That is the nature of worldly life. Those who have renounced this worldly life by giving up responsibilities, obligations and commitments will be free. Because there is nobody to disturb them. And they have no craving or attachment towards anything. Therefore, their minds are very free. No one can disturb them. But very few people can do that. Because they want to develop their attachment. That attachment gives some sort of happiness to them. But the same attachment later create trouble, create worries, create disturbances. It is true. So if you are ready to face all these worries, disturbances, then you can go ahead with your worldly life. But the disturbances are there. Definitely you have to face them. It depends how you face your problems. When there are some problems, some people cannot tolerate, they fight and quarrel and beat and create violence and bloodshed also. That is their attitude. Then they create further and further, more and more disturbances. That is not the end of the problem. Some others just ignore. If not, just tolerate. Let it be anything. We have to face them. And they do not create trouble. They do not disturb others. They swallow their problem. Without creating further problems, without allowing others also to suffer, they tolerate. To do that, they can use this religious knowledge. Then you can remember, the Buddha says like this, what to do when we are in trouble? What to do when others hate us? What to do when others disturb us? Then his saying, his advice, we can apply. Then we can forget those disturbances. I have seen thousands of our youth, because I have been associating with them for the last 40 years. Those young boys and girls, when they were very young, who used to come to this temple to attend various religious classes, talks and discussions and meditations. Yes, they were very peaceful, very obedient, very religious minded, very useful young boys and girls. Later, they find out a job. they find out the partner, their marriage partner. After that they produce children. Now it's very difficult for us to see them. Very seldom they come to the temple. Very seldom they attend to religious activities or talks or meditation. Occasionally when we meet them, they say, why we didn't see you for a long time? We are in hell. We have no time to come to the temple. All day and night we are working like slaves to support our families. Our children are always sick. They create troubles and problems, always go to the doctor. Wife is sick, and not only that, she is always grumbling and grumbling and grumbling, and no peace. You know, I was a very cheerful, very happy person. Now I am very sad, very unfortunate person. I have no time to think of my religion. This is the situation. Many people had to face this. This is worldly problems. So we had to prepare how to face these calamities, misunderstanding and shoutings and quarrelings and arguments. Otherwise, where is happiness in our life? Life can become very miserable, meaningless. Worldly life is like this. So, now you can understand your knowledge that you gathered when you are very young. Maintain this knowledge and this memory. When you grow up, when you go back to your worldly life, then the troubles and problems and difficulties arise. You can use your knowledge as weapons to protect, maintain your peace, the purpose of your life. Otherwise life becomes useless. So religious knowledge or this understanding or these teachings are very important. Not only that, after working, after enjoying, after suffering, one day there will be an end to our life, because we cannot live forever. When we are very old, at that time we cannot walk, we cannot do any work, we cannot see properly, we cannot hear, and memory also very poor, and we cannot eat, we cannot sleep, and we do not know what to do with this life. Become nuisance to others and burden to ourselves. That is the most miserable stage. If you learn this earlier, according to our religion, we can spend our time without worrying. We can maintain some sort of contentment or satisfaction by thinking all the good deeds what we have done at that age. So when we maintain that happiness by thinking all the good deeds what we have done after our death, the next life also cannot become a miserable one. We have already prepared our next life. While doing some service to others, by following or leading a religious way of life, we are creating or we are molding our next life. Then, when we are going to die, we maintain that confidence. Oh, why worry? I have done so much good deeds. I led a religious way of life. After my death, I know my life never become miserable one, and then can die with confidence. Now that is the second period, where religion can assist us. First, religion teach us how to face all our problems and trouble. Now religion is supporting us, give confidence when we are going to die one day. After our death, the next existence or the next life, that we have molded, created by doing meritorious deeds or good deeds, then we can lead very peaceful, very happy, very prosperous life without sufferings. You have seen, not in this country, in many other parts of the world, how human beings suffer, how they die without food, how many millions are dying without clothing, without medicine, without a shelter. Some are blind and deaf and dumb and crippled and mad and very unfortunate. That means they have not followed this advice given by the Buddha during their previous birth. If they have followed this advice, their life never become to be an unfortunate or miserable life. Now you can compare your life with them. You can see the difference. When people are dying without food, we can say we have more than enough food. When people are dying even during the winter and summer or rainy days without a piece of cloth for them to wear, we can say we have more than enough clothing. When people are dying at the pavement, roadside, under the trees, without a shelter, without a house, we can say at least we have a shelter for us to live, to sleep. Again we can say we are not mad, we are not blind, we are not crippled, we are not mentally retarded. But all these facilities we get because of our good deeds, good karma. By knowing this, we should not neglect, we should not forget to do more and more good deeds or good karma to continue our life until we stop this one day. When we get fed up, we will stop this. And this is the main reason why we have to follow a religious way of life. That means, until we attain our final goal, means freedom and salvation or liberation. Salvation from all physical and mental burden, that is salvation, liberation. On the way, life after life, where life exists, we need many things. We need food, clothing, medicine, shelter, and we like to have pleasure, happiness. Yes, we gain all these things if we have done some good deeds, meritorious deeds. If we have not done these things, it is very difficult for us to gain. And those who suffer in this world without these facilities are unfortunate because they have neglected religious way of life and doing some service to others. They are so stingy, so selfish, so ignorant, and they never learned how to make use of this life to serve others, to help others. Then we serve ourselves by helping others. Now you can understand why religion is needed. It is important to learn these things and to prepare how to face all these worldly problems and to prepare our next life and how to continue our life without suffering until we attain our final salvation. I think our young boys and girls can understand what I mentioned. So try your best to improve your knowledge and understanding, and when you grow up, then you get better ideas and make use of your life to do some service to others, to help others, without developing jealousy or anger or cruelty or creating disturbances. Then you also can live peacefully. You can continue your studies without disturbances if you can reduce these evil thoughts from your mind. As now, I invite you to ask questions, especially from our young people. They do not know how to ask questions. So what did they learn so far? How many religious talks are there? Did they learn anything? There will be another group, about 70 of them will be coming here for 3 days from the university. If no questions, okay, let us transfer the merits here. And follow me here. Page 112 or 211, the other way around. Those who have books, 211. Right. Imina punya kamena.
Imina punya kamena.
Upajaya gunottara. Achari upakaracha.
Achari upakaracha.
Mata pita piyamamam.
Mata pita piyamamam.
Suriyo chandimaraja.
Suriyo chandimaraja.
Gunavanta narapiche. Brahma Maharaja Indache.
Brahma Maharaja Indache.
Lokapalacha Devata.
Lokapalacha Devata.
यमो मित्ता मनुषाच मज्जत्ता वेरिकापिच सब्बे सत्ता सुखी हन्तु पुञ्ञानि पकतानि मे सुखं च त्रिविधं दिन्तु किप्पं पापेत ओमतां इमिना पुञ्ञकम्मेन इमिना उद्दिशेन च किप्पाहं सुलभे चेव तन्नोपादान चेदनं नेहि न धम्मा याव निब्बानतो ममं नस्सन्तु सब्बदायेव यत्थ जातो भवे भवे चित्तो सतिपन्नो सल्लेखो वीर्यवामिना मारा लभन्तु नो कागं कातुञ्च वीर्येषु मे दीपावरो नातो धम्मो नातो वरुत्तमो नातो पच्चेकलं बुद्धो संगो नातोत्तरो ममं मानुभावेन मारोका संलभन्तु मा